Samuel 7, beginning at verse 12. The next reading will be from Acts chapter 1 and then 2 Timothy 3. If you can just find those chapters, we'll get to that portion and we'll read. 2 Samuel 7, let's begin there, beginning at verse 12. It says, God speaking to David through the prophet, when your days are fulfilled and you rest with your fathers when you die, is what that means, I will set up your seed after you, who will come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father, and he shall be my son. If he commits iniquity, I will chasten him with the rod of men and with the blows of the sons of men. But my mercy shall not depart from him, as I took it from Saul, whom I removed from before you. And your house and your kingdom shall be established forever before you. Your throne shall be established forever. And according to all these words and according to all this vision, so Nathan spoke to David. If you will now turn in the apostolic writings to the book of Acts chapter 1. We also read this portion several times in this season. Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. The former account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and to teach until the day in which he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he also presented himself alive after his sufferings by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or seasons which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And one final portion in 2 Timothy chapter 3, the last verses of that chapter, verse 24, 25, and 26. Let me see. Hold on just a moment. It's chapter 2. I'm sorry. It's not 3. It's chapter 2. 2 Timothy chapter 2, 24. 2:24. 2 Timothy 2, beginning at verse 24. And a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach, patient, in humility correcting those who are in opposition, if God perhaps will grant them repentance, so that they may know the truth, and that they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil, having been taken captive by him to do his will. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Yeshua, Jesus of Nazareth, thank you for this day that we are able to draw near again to your presence through Jesus the Christ and his finished works. Thank you that you receive us. Thank you that you accept us. And now we pray, Lord, that as we search the scriptures, that you would help us to understand. So in the words of King David, open our eyes, that we may behold wondrous things out of your Torah and out of the writings of Messiah's apostles in Yeshua's name, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you can turn back to 2 Samuel again, put your marker there. Actually, we'll probably go to Exodus 12 and about thereabouts. If you ask anyone today about the days that we're living in, everybody is going to agree that we're living in crazy times. You should try asking that. Are these crazy times or what? And everybody will agree that, of course, if they're keeping in touch with what's happening, if they are observant to the changes that are taking place and have been doing so for some time, but especially recently, and certainly these times qualify as crazy times. We watched a video on Wednesday night, and just incredible the things that are taking place, not just in our culture but around the world, things like this gender identity politics, in which now it is so often heard just about everywhere on television, on materials that you read concerning gender identity, that what we have created mean, like somebody once said, I think we should make men and women, like some men, some culture one day said, I think we should divide the human race into men and women. That's how they're talking, that's as if it's our idea. And say, and then they say, well, this is a construct, something that has been created. It really isn't that way. It isn't the case. There is no such thing. And so now we have 31 different ways in which people describe themselves as being, beginning with, of course, the homosexual and the lesbian, and then the queer and whatever you want to call them. I don't even want to even go there, find out what those names are, what those labels are. 31 different ways. Did you ever think we would ever have that problem? And already they're seeing the confusion that this is going to create everywhere if this catches on and it doesn't show any sign of slowing down. 31 different gender identities. Who would have thought that we would come to a place in which it would be agreed that we should redefine what marriage is? And now we have all kinds of definitions of what marriage is. The traditional family is quickly fading in our culture. Or what family is. What is a family? The definition of that has been altered, has been changed. Now there's different versions. And what's even more astounding, one of the things that is even more astounding is we've got pregnant men. Pregnant men. Of course, we know that they're not men. They're women who want to be men. And but because everything is changing and this is the way our culture is, well, I can be a woman and get pregnant and have a baby and then have the baby and then be the father because gender is fluid. I can change it whenever I want to. Harvard University, the student body passed a notice to the culture there at Harvard University. We want to let you know, we want you to help understand that among the trans community, they're going to change their identity. They can change from day to day. One day they might be this, the next day they're going to be that. So be ready with your pronouns. It's not just him or her or he or she. It's this and zer and all these kinds of pronouns that now you can go to jail if you don't use them. You can be sued for not using these different pronouns and possibly go to jail. It's happening. And this astounding thing that half of our country thinks we should change our way of life. That the vision of our founding fathers no longer applies, that we need to change, we need to be progressive. And half of America wants to change America. That's scary. That's not only crazy, that's scary. Whoever thought that we would get to this place? We are living in crazy times, and you need to keep up with it because you're in the midst of them. We're in the midst of that. But thank God that we are in the midst of all this craziness, thanks God that we are in the midst of a special time. We're in the middle of a special time. This time that we're living in right now, the people of Israel call it the Passover season. And it happens every year. The Passover season, they call it the season of our deliverance. They coined this expression, and we've accepted it. We take it upon ourselves. I'd rather live in a season than just a celebration of a day, which is the tradition. But no, biblically, we are in a season. It is a Passover season. It's a span of time, that began with the observance of Passover. The observance of Passover, and then the observance of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and then the observance of the Feast of the first of the harvest, rather, which is first fruits. And it continues even now with what is called the counting of the Omer, or the counting of the 49 days from Passover to the next feast, the one that we are anticipating, the Feast of Weeks, the Feast of Shavuot. Taken together, these 50 days in the Jewish culture and now in our lives, this is a season. It is the Passover season, the season of our deliverance, the season of our redemption. And these are important days. These are important days. They're important to God. They're important to God because it is God who designated these days as holy. Days to be set apart from the rest of the days, meaning that they serve a special purpose. Whenever God designates something as holy, He elevates it from being common, whatever it is, or whoever they are. He elevates that or them from being common, ordinary, and they are set apart and elevated for special purpose, for a special use by God. And these are holy days, a holy season. It's important to God because He designated them. They're important to believers, whether Jew or Gentile, who believe in the God of Abraham and in Jesus the Christ. And they're important for the unbeliever. They're important for the unbeliever who is in darkness, concerning the significance of this season. For them, it's important as well. They're ignorant of why it is significant. They are deceived by the God, small g. They are deceived by the God of this age, and they are ignorant concerning the meaning of these holy days that we're living in. So what are the purpose? What is the purpose of these holy days? What is the purpose of this holy season? Remember this, because every year we're going to come back to this. And every year we need to know that when we come back to this, this is what this is about. It's important. Remember what? Important to God, important to you, important from the one who does not know. Two reasons. Because God wants us to remember. He wants us to remember, which means going back to the past. Obviously, He can remember the past. He wants us to remember, and then He wants us to look forward, to remember and to anticipate. The reason for these days is for remembering and then anticipating, looking forward. And God is the one who tells us this is what you should do. And He needs to tell us, because if we don't hear it from God, the days for us are just ordinary days. We talk about that expression. We use it sometimes too easily. Same old, same old. What's new? Same old, same old. What's happening? Oh, same old, same old. For the body of Christ, there's common days in which we go about the business of life, but then intermittently through the year, there are holy days, and those days are not same old, same old. They're special days. They're set apart days. They are days imbued with the power of God, designed to accomplish a purpose for His glory, for our benefit as believers, for the benefit of the lost and the dead, the blind and the dead. God has designated this season as holy, these days as holy, because He wants us to remember and He wants us to look forward to. And it takes an effort to do that. And it takes an effort to do that, thank God, for the Passover observance that grabs us for 4 hours in a day and takes us back to history. Thank God for the Feast of Unleavened Bread, that for 7 days we remember the significance of who we are. And now, something that we're getting accustomed to, thank God for the 49 days from Passover to the Feast of Weeks, in which we are supposed to be counting the days. We may forget, but we need to be reminded. We're going to provide you with something to help you remember that in these days between now and the Feast of Weeks, we should be counting the days, because this is a special season. This is a holy time for God. We are to set these days aside to remember, so that what we remember can serve three things, can serve as an anchor, as a foundation, anchor, foundation, and as a guide. You know, when you think about these things, you stand in awe of God, of course, who is omniscient, who knows all things, and knows exactly what to provide for us, because He knows who we are. He knows how we are. He knows how we live. He knows what we do, what we will do. And He knows that we forget. He knows that we're easily led astray. He knows that these five senses often get the best of us, and before we know, we forget that we are first spiritual beings in an intimate relationship with God. And so God provides for us the ways to keep us anchored, sitting, standing, living on a foundation and following a guide. And this is what these days are about. An anchor so that we will be kept secure and so that we don't drift away. We know what an anchor is, right? In the area of fishing and all of that. You cast it into the ocean because you want to stay there. It's a weight that keeps you. These days, this season, God intended it to serve as an anchor because you have a whole year in which to drift away. To drift away from who you are and who God wants you to be. And so this season serves as an anchor to secure us so that we don't drift away. That is security. Security. There is no safer place in all of this world than holding the hand of God every moment of every day. That is security, because there is no security anywhere else except in humility and in humble submission to our Creator God, walking with God. That's the only place where you can find security. These days are intended to serve as an anchor so that we do not drift away. God has provided security for us. Foundation. It is provided for us so that it can serve as a foundation. What is a foundation? What do you do with a foundation? You live, rather you build on it. These days are to remind us that we have a foundation upon which we can build our lives. We have a foundation upon which we can build our lives. That means stability. These days remind us that there is stability in the world. If anything can be, if a word can describe our days, it's the opposite. It's chaos and instability. Already, if you will read, you will see the concerns of many who are watching our culture, not just America, but the world, and they are fearful. They are afraid because they see nothing but instability. Nothing but instability. The destruction of categories, the destruction of boundaries, the forsaking of those tried and true standards that have marked our world for centuries. We're seeing it. And there is a fear because the foundations are breaking, they say. The foundations are breaking. What is that scripture? If the foundations are destroyed, where can you stand? Where can you stand? These days are to serve as a foundation to remind us that there is stability. There is stability. And why do you want something stable? Because you want to build your lives on something that isn't going to crumble next year. Next year. The commentators, again, the observers are looking at this gender identity thing, and they fear the destruction that it's going to cause soon, because this is something that cannot be sustained. It cannot be sustained. Among many other things. It serves as an anchor, it serves as a foundation, and it serves as a guide. These days serve as a guide to show us the way on our journey, and not only the way, it isn't just this is the way to go, but this is how you live on the way there. It serves as a guide to show us the way on our journey and how to live. And what that means is that God has provided for us guaranteed fruitfulness, that your life will mean something, that you will produce something lasting, something eternal, something. Whereas it seems to be the thought of the culture that doesn't matter. Just live for the day. Just do what you want to do. Just express yourself, not being concerned with what it is that you produce and what you bring forth and what comes out of your life and the decisions and the choices of your life. These days remind us that God has provided us a guide to show us the way. This is the way. Walk in it. But excuse me, the Lord speaks through his prophet and he gives us how to live on that journey so that our lives produce those things that are good and lasting. This season, we remember that at a time long past, a long time ago, 3,000 years, a long time ago, our Creator God, the God of Abraham, acting on covenant promises. If you'll notice the notes, bold and highlighted. These are the main points. A long time ago, our Creator God, the God of Abraham, acting on covenant promises, intervened in human history and made himself known in all the earth. If you just say that thing to yourself and say it and say it and say it and meditate on it, it brings you back to reality. It's supposed to bring you back to reality. It's supposed to stop you on your tracks and bring you to that place of meditating and thinking deeply on a historical event of great significance. It isn't a small thing. It isn't a small thing. God, because God intervened. What is the definition of the word intervene? Let me give it to you because I've used it a lot. And this is a simple definition of the word intervene, because this is how you describe the act of God in the book of Exodus when he came to Egypt. He intervened. Intervene means to come between. To come between so as to prevent two things. So as to prevent or alter a result or course of events. Do we get that? Intervention. Intervention. To come between. To make a change. To make a correction. This is what God did in Egypt, and this is what this season is about. It is to never forget that. It is to never forget that for a long, 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 long time, it is not life as usual. It is not life as usual. And of course, in this that I'm talking about here, I'm talking about the Exodus event. At the Exodus in Egypt, God didn't just come to deliver his people. Let's listen carefully, because every time we do this, we give a little bit of further insight on what this thing is about. Remember, we're going to go back from Exodus 12. We're going to go back to Genesis. We're not starting there yet, but we're preparing. At the Exodus, God didn't just come to deliver his people, Israel. There was a larger purpose for God intervening. A larger purpose. And this is why. God came down to Egypt, and he came between Pharaoh and the children of Israel. This is God's intervention, to come between. He came between Israel and Pharaoh. And he came there to prevent Pharaoh from continuing in his deception. And what was Pharaoh's deception? It was the deception that he was divine. And because he saw himself as divine, he saw himself as worthy of the worship of men. We don't know what a serious affront it is to God for one man to rule over another man. We think it's a small thing. It's a huge thing, obviously. We see it in the history of our country, in the history of the world. We don't know what an affront it is. In Egypt, God made it a point to make the point, this is an affront to me, first of all, but it is a deception to you. It is a terrible deception. So God intervenes between Israel and Pharaoh because Pharaoh saw himself as divine and he saw himself as worthy of the worship of men. Now, the worship that Pharaoh received wasn't that the Israelites would prostrate themselves and say, "Oh, Pharaoh, God on earth, whatever," and sing in worship songs. It was what they were doing with their being, with their entire bodies, serving Pharaoh, working for Pharaoh, living for Pharaoh, doing for Pharaoh, honoring Pharaoh with their entire being, with their energy, with their strength, with their bodies, with everything, with their entire being, they were being for Pharaoh. Do you get that picture? That's worship. That's exactly what you do with Jesus Christ, as a matter of fact. We always talk about the fact that worshiping Jesus doesn't mean coming here on Sunday and singing a couple of songs or praying. That isn't worship. It's what you do with your entire body. That's why many, many believers, or those who think they're believers, aren't really believers. Because to be a believer, it is to be a worshiper. And to be a worshiper is to offer all that you are, every fiber of your being, in service to Jesus the Christ. This is what was happening in Egypt. Pharaoh took Israel by force and he made them worship him. All that they were for him. And God says, this cannot be. It cannot be. It is a deception. It is something that has to be stopped. And he comes and he intervenes. In rebellion against God, Pharaoh was continually denying truth about God, clearly evident in creation. Clearly evident in creation and actively suppressing the witness of his conscience. How many of you know that you have a conscience? I hope you hear your voice. Conscience is very valuable. It's God-given. It's what's going to lead you to God. Pharaoh in Egypt and what he was doing with Israel was doing two things. He would look at creation and he saw God. And he knew that he wasn't God, but he denied that truth. And his voice inside him told him he was a creature. And he should offer worship to this God that is invisible and couldn't quite fully grasp, but he knew he was there. And he suppressed that knowledge. He suppressed his conscience. How do we know that? Because Paul tells us that. Because Paul teaches us that this is why God intervenes in the history of man. And I want us to read that. Go to Romans. Romans 1. Romans 1 always brings us back to the proper perspective of life. Help us to understand life, to help you and I know what we're doing, why we're doing it. Because this is always the case with men in reference to God. Pharaoh did it on a huge scale, on the scale of an empire. But you and I do it on our local levels, if we're not careful. And this is why the Exodus, the Passover, all of that is so important. Romans chapter 1, beginning at verse 18. For the wrath of God, that's what we saw in Egypt. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who, what? Suppress the truth in unrighteousness, because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, Genesis 1:1, for since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. No one has an excuse. No one can defend themselves, in other words, in light of this truth. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, but were... Oh, hold on, I lost my place here. Nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man and birds and four-footed animals and creeping things. Therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lusts of their hearts, to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshiped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. This is the truth of what all men do and what Pharaoh had done on this empire, on the scale of an empire, oppressing. And his rebellion against God, in refusing to release the children of Israel. Now remember, this is the greater purpose for God's intervention. We're looking at what happened at the Exodus from a different perspective. A perspective that is offered for us from other portions of Scripture. This is the way the Bible works. This is the way God has revealed truth. In his rebellion against God, in refusing to release the children of Israel, Pharaoh stood in the way of God's greater purpose for Israel. There was a greater purpose for Israel, the promises of the Abrahamic covenant. This is why God came to Egypt. Because in his obstinance, in his suppressing of the truth, Pharaoh wasn't just making it difficult for Israel. They had it hard. They served with rigor. It was a horrible life. But the life of slavery wasn't why God came. Their pain wasn't why God came. Certainly, he wanted to relieve them of it. But it was something bigger than that. It was Pharaoh standing in the way, in front of, as an obstacle to greater purposes for Israel. That greater purposes involved the promises of the Abrahamic covenant. What was that? To make Israel a mighty and blessed nation, one, and then through them to bless all the families of the earth. When God comes down to Egypt, he has that in mind. He has the Abrahamic covenant. He has the promises made to Abraham. It involves Israel as a people, and it involves the entire planet. And there is this obstinate, stiff-necked, truth-suppressing man. And he comes down, and he intervenes. He intervenes. And so with the deliverance of the children of Israel, God alters. Remember the definition of intervention? To come between, to alter. With the deliverance of the children of Israel, God altered human history in that he bound himself to Israel in an unbreakable covenant of love and faithfulness. This had never happened before. He binds himself to a covenant with this people. Exodus 19 and 20. What is the consequence of that? Is that they would then be his people and he would be their God. And I'm going very slow and very deliberate on this because I want us to be able to chart this path of spiritual truth. To fill these days with substance. And this is what's missing. We talked about the traditional celebration of the resurrection. And what a sad thing it is that it has substance, doesn't it? For 90% of the Christian world, that day has substance, but not enough of the right substance. It's filled with stuff that is worthless, much of it. That which is value is limited, very, very little, not sufficient to make any difference the next day. The next day, the celebration is forgotten, and we go on, or they go on, with their schedule. God doesn't do that in his word. He knows that that's not sufficient. He gives us 50 days to live in a season that is filled with substance, substantive truth, to anchor us, to remind us of the foundation, to remind us of the guide. And so this is that substance. This is insight into that substance. With the deliverance of Israel, God alters human history in that he binds himself with the people in an unbreakable covenant of love and faithfulness, and that makes them his people, and that makes him their God. And so from that moment on in Exodus, from that moment on, the Creator, the one and only true God, he would have a people that would represent him on the earth, a people that would represent him on the earth, a people through whom he would make himself known to all the earth. And so as they begin their eternal relationship together, he establishes the Exodus as the defining point in their history. He tells them literally over and over, you will never forget the Exodus. And of course, we understand that he incorporates that, the memory of that, in the Passover event, but much more. He establishes the Exodus as a defining event in their history, an event that is to be the anchor for them as his people, a focal point that they would always remind them of who they were and why they exist in the world. This is the value of Passover. Because in this event and in this celebration is identity, is significance, is destiny, purpose for you and for me. The very first words of the covenant that God makes with Israel here. He has a covenant that he makes with Abraham that covers everything else, but there he makes a covenant with his people Israel. It's the Mosaic covenant. I want you to go to Exodus 20. The very first words that God incorporates into the written words of this covenant, because it becomes the first something never seen before in history, in which laws and commandments are codified and written down. A record is kept. An awesome reality that God says, write down what I tell you so that you can verify my behavior. You know the value of this Bible? You know the value of this Bible? Is that you can check God's behavior against this. You can look at history and then check this book and confirm whether God has kept his word or not. This is why you have this, and this is why it's never been destroyed. This is why it keeps being transmitted over and over and over. This is why the devil wants to dilute it, water it down, but he never will, because the essence of these truths are kept by the people of Israel. The people of Israel will never do that, the Jewish people. We have 100 different kinds of, 100 different translations, and most of them are watered down, but there's always a Torah, and there's always the prophets, and Israel has that. And we will always know the truth. Because why? Because God wants everyone to be able to confirm the integrity of his character. I said I would do this. Now check my character. And you will always find God faithful to his word. He wanted that from Israel, and so he wrote it for the same purpose, so that Israel could check their behavior against the truths and the words of the covenant. And the first thing that he writes on that covenant, when he begins to write it down, you find it in Exodus 20, verse 2. And God spoke all these words. Remember, he's writing these words. He's saying these words. Moses will write them down on tablets of stone after they have agreed that they will enter into a covenant with them, with him, rather. As after they say, yes, God, whatever you say, we will do. And God says, okay, I'm going to write down the nature of our relationship. And it is no coincidence, and it isn't insignificant, that when God begins to write these things down, what does he say in verse 2? Look at verse 2. Beginning of verse 1. God spoke all these words, saying, I am Yahweh, your Elohim, your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. What does that mean? It means that the Exodus is of extreme importance to his people Israel, and to you and to me. If he refuses to let them forget that, and he writes it, and it's the first thing that he writes in that written document that they will carry for them forever, it is because it matters. It is because it matters. And so he begins his relationship by telling them, I am the God who brought you out of Egypt. I am the God who intervened in your situation and saved you because you could never save yourself, but I intervened for a greater and mightier purposes, and I will tell you about all of that as our relationship continues. Now, you're not going to find any of that written down there, but it's there. I will tell you the greater picture, the greater purpose, the greater design, but for the moment, all you need to know, and you always want to keep this at the very forefront of your memory and your heart and everything about you, you will never forget this event. I am the God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You will not have any other gods before me, besides me. This is the beginning of his relationship with Israel. And this is why he commands them to remember the Passover, and why he says that it is to be an eternal ordinance, to be observed to the age. Because it is that moment in human history in which God steps in and changes the course of history. And now we have in the world redemptive history, a plan of salvation, a plan of redemption. And what did John say, or what did Jesus say in his prayer to God? But what is salvation? Salvation is knowing God and Jesus Christ, whom he sent. This is eternal life, Jesus says in his prayer to the Father. And I believe it's John 19, or 17 or 19, one of those two chapters. Salvation is knowing God and Jesus Christ. God is preparing the way for that. And it begins here. And you can't know God unless you understand the Exodus event. You can't appreciate Jesus unless you know the Exodus event. And this is why God does what he does. In the centuries that followed the Exodus, God would constantly refer to the Exodus in his dealings with his people Israel. I have a list of all the scriptures in which God, through the centuries, would always remind Israel in his dealings, whether they were rebellious and they were forgetting, whether they were getting too relaxed, whether they were asking too many questions about the cultures around them and the gods of the world. When they were getting lazy and they were forgetting who they were, he will always remind them, I am the God who brought you out of Egypt. to get them back, to center them in that truth. Why did he do that? Because the work that God desired to accomplish with the Exodus was not yet finished. God did something awesome at the Exodus, but it wasn't a complete work. There was more to be done. It wasn't yet finished. There was something yet future. God had promised Israel there as he brought them out at the foot of Mount Sinai. He promised Israel that if they entered into that covenant with him, they would be for him a kingdom of priests and a holy nation, his own special treasure. You will be to me a kingdom of priests, my holy nation, my own special treasure. And with that, he elevates them above the nations of the earth. Just by that calling, just by that designation. Remember what I said about when God declares something to be holy, it immediately rises in value to God and therefore value to everyone else. Here in Exodus 19 and 20, God tells Israel, this is what you will be to me. So what has happened at the Exodus isn't the end of it. It's only the beginning. There's something yet to be done. God creating his kingdom, his own special nation. Centuries after the Exodus, the Lord announces his plans for the establishment of this kingdom that he talked to Israel about. To establish it firmly, in their earth. Because up until this moment, there is instability in the kingdom. There is failure in the kingdom. There is falling short of the glory of God in the people of God. But God does something awesome in 2 Samuel chapter 7, which we read a while ago in the very beginning. God announces his plans for the establishment. Establishment. I'm going to lay it down and it's going to be. When you establish something, you lay it down and it's going to be there. Otherwise, you can't use the word establish. The word establish, it implies that whatever you set is there to stay. It is there to stay. And the word establish is used several times in reference to the kingdom, in reference to the family of David, in reference to the king of David, in reference to the throne. All of these, God says, they will be established. Once they are set, they are there eternally. And so in 2 Samuel, go there again very rapidly so that we don't run out of time. 2 Samuel 7. When you die, after your death, I will set up your seed, your descendants after you, who will come from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. The word seed there is in reference to one. I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be his father. He shall be my son. If he commits iniquity, I will chasten him with the rod of men and with the blows of the sons of men. But my mercy shall not depart from him as I took it from Saul, whom I removed from before you. And your house and your kingdom shall be established forever before you. Your throne shall be established forever. Established forever. We note here that God makes a promise. He essentially says, your sons are going to stray because we can't do anything but stray unless God intervenes and unless God helps. And this is the help of God here. My mercy shall not depart. My mercy shall not depart from you like I took it from Saul. When did God take his mercy from Saul? When Saul disobeyed, when Saul fell, God rejected Saul, cast him aside. God says to David, I will never do that to you. You're going to fall, you're going to fail, you're going to falter, you're going to sin, you're going to rebel, you're going to break, but I will not remove my mercy from you. And so here is essentially a promise that God will not let this house, he will not let this dynasty, he will not let this throne, this kingdom fall. He will not let it fall. But what does that mean? It means that it is present even now, isn't it? It's present even now. God promised David that he would reign in the earth through the family, through his family eternally. He would reign in the earth through this family eternally. I'm going very, very fast. through the words of the prophets. Look at Isaiah 9. We're skipping through centuries of time because we want to understand why this season is significant and why this is exactly what God provides, knowing that there would come a time when it would be crazy, when it would be chaotic, where there would be no solid ground anywhere to stand. But yet there is. It is what he has established, his kingdom. And his kingdom is here. In Isaiah chapter 9 at verse 6, the promise of that son of David, the promise of that one son of David to inherit this kingdom. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end upon the throne of David and over his kingdom to order it and establish it with judgment and justice from that time forward, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Centuries before, God says, your kingdom is established. Centuries later, God says, I will establish the kingdom. This is how God works. He says, it's done, but it's not yet done. But because God said that it's done, it's done. Right? It's done. In Genesis 1, at the very beginning of human history, God said, the devil is dead. And the devil is dead right now? No, he's not. But the devil is dead. Because God has declared it. To David, it says, your throne is established, your house is established, your seat is established. But is it? No, not yet. Here he says that it will be established. It's going to be established. It's coming. Here is a promise of Isaiah that it would come. In Luke chapter 1, in the Gospel of Luke, Luke chapter 1, beginning at verse 26, centuries after Isaiah, 600 years. Luke 1, 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, Miriam. And having come in, the angel said to her, rejoice, highly favored one. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women. But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son. And his name, you shall call his name Yeshua, Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob, the house of Israel. The house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Here is Jesus. He has come. Brother, he is going to come here in Luke. He's going to be born. He is the son of David, the heir, the eternal heir of the eternal kingdom of David. This is what these days are about. This is the substance of these days. This is what fills these days that we are to immerse ourselves in and come back to them and let them be anchors for our souls, for our lives. Let them be foundations upon which we stand. Let them guide the steps we take every single day, no matter what is happening in our world. And what about those lost? Well, we look forward because these mighty acts speak of things yet future. Jesus Christ says to his disciples in the book of Acts chapter 1, he has arisen from the dead. And these are the days. These days are the days in which Jesus is walking in the earth, alive after his resurrection. He didn't go up to heaven right after he resurrected. For 40 days, he's walking with his original disciples. More or following him, and he's teaching them, he's instructing them, he's reinforcing them, all the teaching that he's given them in the past 3 years, letting them know, you can believe everything I told you. The resurrection assures that the kingdom is here and the kingdom is eternal. It is established, and this message needs to go to the world. the apostles ask him, are you going to give us the kingdom now? He doesn't tell them no. He doesn't tell them yes. He says, not yet. The Father knows when. You don't have to know when. Just know that it is. What purpose would have been all the teaching of the kingdom for 40 days if it wasn't to assure them that the kingdom would come? It is that that gives birth to that question. Are you going to establish it now, Yeshua? Are you going to bring it to us now, Yeshua? No. It's not for you to know when. For the moment, you need to do something. You need to be witnesses. You need to be representatives. You need to be ambassadors to Israel and to the nations of the earth. Go and tell them the kingdom of God is here. Believe in the kingdom. Believe in the king, because the king has come and he died, but God raised him from the dead. That's the message that the world needs to hear. They need to be connected to these events. They need to know that in this time, in this season, these things took place. God intervened. God changed and altered history. It is not life as usual. There is a kingdom that has been established. There is a king that is waiting to come. And the call is repent and believe. Repent and believe. In Acts chapter 17, go very rapidly there. Here is the Apostle Paul doing exactly that. And here is a pattern for you and for me. How do you tell people about Yeshua? Here is a pattern, not word for word, but the gist of it, much of it. Acts 17, 24, God talking, Paul talking to unbelievers who believe in gods, but the wrong gods, the false gods. He's telling them about the real God, the true God, the creator God, God who made the world and everything in it. Since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands. He is not worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, since he gives to all life, breath, and all things, and he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on the face of the earth and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings so that they should seek the Lord in the hope that they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as also some of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. Therefore, since we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone, something shaped by art and man's devising. Truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained, and he has given assurance of all this by raising him from the dead. If you read this carefully, you realize that this preaching, this mini sermon by the Apostle Paul, actually answers all the objections that people are raising today. I mean, you can just lift it right out, word for word, and tell it to an unbeliever, and it would have the impact that it had in this first century, because it's all truth. And the deceptions of the devil are always the same. The devil has not come up with one new lie. The lies have always been the same ones. The deceptions have always been the same ones. And the gospel addresses every one of them. And here, the Apostle Paul steps out of the boundaries of Israel and goes into the nations of the world and addresses their idolatry, addresses the darkness, addresses their ignorance with their history. The history that they know and the history that they've lived as the chosen people of God, as the representatives of the kingdom. And he brings the truth to this people. And we are to do the same. I want you to look at 2 Timothy and we'll finish here. And we are called to do the same. These days are to remind us that we are in exactly the same position, that we are not those who will simply live out these days as common days. No common days for the people of God, just a few of them throughout the year. 2 Timothy chapter 24, the Apostle Paul giving Timothy advice on how to express his faith, how to live his life in the middle of an unbelieving world, and in a time in which he describes these days as being perilous. Even then they were perilous times. But look at verse 24, 2 Timothy. This is what you do, Timothy. It says, a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach, patient, in humility correcting those who are in opposition, not to you, opposition to God. In opposition, if God perhaps will grant them repentance so that they may know the truth and that they may come to their senses. Can we say that in our culture people are losing their mind? It literally, we need to help them come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil, having been taken captive by him to do his will. Isn't this similar to Israel in Egypt? Captive, deceived, blind, ignorant. And their salvation comes about only because of the intervention of God. You and I are called to be those who intervene with the good news, with the gospel. But what would move us? This would move us, that these people are blind, they're deceived, they're bound. And God calls us to speak gently, carefully, humbly. There's no need to shout. There's no need to get forceful. There's no need, because you're not doing anything. It's the power of God. It's the Spirit of God. It's the kingdom of God that is active on the earth, working to deliver the blind and the slaves who are bound by the god of this age, who are captive, doing the will of Satan. Doing the will of Satan. I came across this term a long time ago, and I've been debating all week long whether to use it as an example, but I will. I think we understand, and I'll finish here. In the early century, in the early part of the last century, with communism and all of that, it is believed that the leaders of the revolution, the communist revolutions, Lenin or Stalin, coined a phrase. The phrase was useful idiot. Who has heard that word? Useful idiot. If you haven't heard it, listen, you're going to hear it in our culture, because it's one way to describe many people who are following all of these trends and those that want to see our country changed into a socialism, whatever. They're bringing back this term because it fits. Useful idiot. Now, from Lenin's, if he's the one who coined it, and these people, from their point of view, it described a person who work with them unknowingly, promoting their ideology, promoting communism, promoting Marxism. It's amazing, you know. And again, if you're not watching, if you're not reading, if you're not investigating, you don't know that in our universities are filled with teachers who are teaching our students, our children who are going to universities, how horrible America is and why we need to go to Marxism and be communist and be socialist. And it is taking root in our universities. And they're going out there promoting and telling everybody, demonstrating, and just becoming so involved in telling America what a horrible nation we are, we need to change. These are useful idiots. There's already ample evidence that socialism is horrible, that communism is devastating, that millions have died because of these, and yet still, these individuals still go out, still need to, if we need to change our democratic form of government, everybody needs to have an equal share, we all need to be equal, all that stuff. We don't have time to go into all of that. But this is what this term is about. It's about someone ignorantly participating in a plan that is harmful. And the author of that plan holds them in contempt. This is what you will read when you read about Lenin and using the term useful idiots. It was a way of speaking in contempt of these ridiculous people who were helping them promote communism in the free countries and the democracies. If you're not careful, if we're not careful, we can ourselves be useful idiots, and that we're not aware of all this truth, of all this substance that God has brought into the world, this truth that is supposed to alert us to the plan of the enemy. And because we don't commit ourselves to this truth, because we don't draw near to this truth, because we don't grab the hand of God and agree that this is reality and agree that this is the way it is and humbly submit to him and speak his words and speak his truth, you're going to speak something. You're going to say something. You're not going to be silent. What are you going to say? What are you going to speak? We are called to promote and to manifest the kingdom of God. We are called to speak in the name of Jesus the Christ. We are to do what that for that purpose for which Israel got delivered out of Egypt and brought near to God to be representatives of God on the earth so that God could have a conduit to make himself known in the world. That is who we are. And these days remind us of that. These days bring us back to the fact that you're not living for yourself, that we're living for the glory of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Israel, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has set in motion the plan of redemption and salvation because man is dead in trespasses and sins. And the world is full of useful idiots, ignorantly promoting the plans of the devil, ignorantly promoting the lies and the deceptions of the devil, ignorantly living in them and fleshing them out themselves. That's what Ephesians 2 says, that this is who we were until the Lord Jesus Christ came into our lives and delivered us and brought us out and brought us into that foundation, the kingdom of God. We're counting the days until the next feast, the Feast of Weeks, to remember the day in which God gave Israel the commandments that brought true freedom to these former slaves. Because until they had those laws, they did not know the will of God, and therefore they did not know how to live as free men. And then we remember that day, 1500, 1800 years ago, in which there in Jerusalem, the Holy Spirit descends and fills that remnant of Israel, a remnant of Jewish men and women, and makes them empowered, supernaturally empowered, to go and tell about the kingdom and demonstrate it. And as they continue, the Torah begins to get written upon their hearts and they internalize it. The next feast remembers the day God comes down on Mount Sinai and gives to the world a way of life, the only way to live a righteous, just, holy life. And then we remember the day the Holy Spirit comes to make it possible, to make it possible to live that life without excuse, to go outside, to say that good news, to tell that good news, to express that good news, and then to trust in God to manifest the reality of it. Today, it is the 11th day. We are counting the days. It is the 11th day of the Omer. This afternoon at sundown will be the 12th day. You count at sundown, at 12th day. The next day at sundown will be the 13th day. I'll say this so that you can be prepared and be counting. We're going to give you a schedule. Looking forward to the Feast of Weeks. Counting, the simple act of counting, will bring us back to the fact that these are special days. That in the midst of these crazy times, there is a plan of salvation. That it isn't chaotic, that God is in control. That it isn't being destroyed, the kingdom of God cannot be destroyed. And we are those citizens of that kingdom. These are the days designed to give us hope. So if you're hopeless, if you're concerned, if you're afraid, look at these days. Immerse yourself in the scriptures. Immerse yourself in all this substance and let the Spirit of the Lord lift you up and raise you up, and let the Spirit of God empower you, empower me to testify, to speak, to share, to pray, to intercede. Not give up, not run, not hide, not wish that it would be different. No, have faith in the God of Abraham, that what he set in motion in the Exodus is going strong today. And it isn't going to end until Jesus the Christ returns to complete that plan, to complete that process. And we are waiting for the return of Jesus the Christ. Let's stand, if you will. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Yeshua, in the name of Jesus. Lord God, it is difficult, O Lord, to look around us and not feel a bit of despair, O Lord, as we see the constant changes that are taking place in our world, in our culture. We see it in friends. We see it in family members. Lord God, rapidly, Father, we are departing from you. And we know, Lord God, that you prophesied that in the last days there would be a falling away. But you have given us the good news that there is an anchor. There is an anchor. It is Jesus the Christ, who has ascended to your right hand and is even now seated there, interceding on our behalf, our high priest, our advocate, our mediator. Thank you, Lord, that he lives to intercede for us. Help us, Father, that in these days we do not lose sight of what you have appointed. You have appointed holy days for us, sacred set-apart days to remember your mighty acts, the things that you have done in history, to know that those acts, the power of those acts remain, they stand, the truth of them remain, it stands, Lord God. And then you cause us, Father, to look to the future, to know that the plan is not yet complete, that we can anticipate the fulfillment of it, and it will be accomplished, Lord, with the return of Jesus the Christ, Yeshua, the Son of David, to fulfill all of your promise to establish your glorious kingdom. Father, we are thankful to know that we have a place at that in that kingdom even now. Through faith in Jesus the Christ, our names have been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. A place has been prepared for us in that household of God. Lord, may we in our life, in our days, be faithful. May we seek this anchor. May we build on this foundation. May we rely on this as our one and only guide, that we may continue, Lord, to be the representatives, Father, the ambassadors of this glorious kingdom, and that our lives may be fruitful for the glory of your great name. Help us, O Lord. Help us to be those, Lord, that you can move through whom you may act, through whom you can reveal yourself in our day, for the glory and the praise of your great name, for the honor of Yeshua, who has laid down his life. In his name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. God bless us. We're going to try to get to you as quickly as possible a list of the counting of the Omer. We have several days, of course, to go. And again, just counting, just remembering that every day goes by, we're closer to that feast day, and of course to remind us to be praying for that special day, for the Feast of Weeks, to remember what all that's about, to desire to have God accomplish something in our lives. If God says that these are holy days, it means that they're holy days. It means that they are filled with power, with the potential of blessing from God. Let's pursue that. Let's think on that. And let's not allow the world and the schedules and everything that is taking place in our lives to divert us away from that. We are the special, holy, set-apart, chosen people of God. Let's not forget that. These are the days to cultivate that. Okay? All right. This afternoon at 6, we're going to talk tonight at 6 o'clock about the portion that we read concerning the kingdom of David. It's so important to park there a little bit and talk about that and focus on that. We had never heard about the kingdom of David. Never. I know that. I know you know that. We had never been told about it. We had never been taught about it, and we were the poorer for it, as is the body of Christ, poorer for the fact that they don't know about the promises made to David and who Jesus really is. And we don't want to continue poor in that respect, and that we don't have this revelation. We don't have that thing that will root us in the faith of our Savior, Jesus Christ, that will then guarantee the blessing and the fruitfulness of our lives. That's how we get there. I hope that you're able to join us tonight at 6 o'clock, okay? All right. Monday we pray. Let us know what your request is so that we can pray. Wednesday we continue in our study of the kingdom. So hopefully you can come. All right, let's pray.